Yo, what's cracking? It's your boy Classic, and I'm here on WSUM 91.7 FM Madison, and you are listening to Let's Talk About It. So, firstly, let me say before we even get started, the opinions expressed on this show do not reflect the views of WSUM, University of Wisconsin-Madison, or its Board of Regents. So, LaToya and I, we're going to get started in a second. We actually just pre-recorded our show for next week. So, LaToya is in the other studio. She's wrapping up some things with our other guests. And in the meantime, I'm just going to play a song to get us through the next couple of minutes. Hopefully, she's in here by then. And then we can get started on our show. But I'm hoping that you all will not leave. You'll stay around to listen to the show. Today's topic will be concerning if the food programs and meal plans on university campuses are biased or set up against low-income students. So this should be a really interesting topic to dive into, some of the administrative things going into universities and how that operates. But for now, I'm going to get us into this song, and we will be right back. Thank you. Looks like we're having some difficulties here with the music. Let's see if we can get this rolling really quick. Huh. Let's see, guys. Well, I guess I'm going to just talk. I hope everybody's having a good day. I'm having a pretty good day. Have some midterms next week. So, you know, that's just great. We love midterm season. Have 3 midterms all next week. If you're in any of my classes, feel free to say hi. I'm in Econ 102, Comm Arts 355, Consumer Science 355, Consumer Science 275, and Consumer Science 251. So if you see me in any of those classes, feel free to say hi. Stop me and ask me about the show. I would love to talk about it and see how you guys feel about the show and all that kind of jazz. But I think I got the song up, so I'm going to get into that right now. Thank you.
Restless, just need time to think, so much pressure. If you wanna be my girlfriend, 'cause I'm on the road, I don't wanna hear you tell me you told me so.
If it was me who fell in love with you, someone who won't be home, I feel so lonely just because I want you all for my own. But if it don't, I guess okay, 'cause I'll be here for you all day.
Students, protect your inner space from outer space and get a free flu shot from UHS. Getting a flu shot isn't just about you. You're helping to keep others healthy and create community immunity. It's fast, too. You can be in and out in 10 minutes. Stop by the 6th floor of UHS or visit a satellite clinic location. For more information about getting a flu shot, go to uhs.wisc.edu.
Were you just rocking out to that last song but not sure what it's called? Have no fear. Visit our website at wsum.org to check out what we've just played. Or if it was a song from before, click on the Spinatron Playlist tab to see what we've been playing this week. Make sure to be up to date with everything happening at wsum.org.
Trying to do right.
Yo, what's up, y'all? We are back. LaToya is finally in the building after handling some things for our show next week. We are finally prepared to get into this one, so I will let her take it away.
Hey, 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 guys. So once again, it's LaToya Michelle, and as I'm sure Darian always already said, that this is WSUM 91.7 FM Madison. This week's topic is going to be about meal plans, actually, and it's going to be a two-part thing, so we're going to bounce around both topics. One, are meal plans something like that's actually discriminatory towards lower income students, but also does all you can eat encourage unhealthy eating habits, particularly like binging? So that's what we're gonna talk about today. With us in the studio we have Jessica. Jessica, do you want to just introduce yourself, say hello to everyone?
I'm Jessica.
Yes, so if you are like, I feel like I've known that before, because she has been a guest on our show before. But yeah, to take it away, once again, talking about meal plans, I'm going to start by saying I've gone to Rita's. Rita's is a dining hall here on campus. Rita's this year started this new thing where they do all you can eat. So they do all you can eat breakfast for $3.50. This is for students. I'm not sure the price. I mean, students who are residents. So I'm not sure the price for non-residents for breakfast. I know the price for non-residents for lunch is $10, but for residents is $4.50. And the price for dinner for residents is going to be $5.50. And since they've incorporated this policy just this year, I've definitely noticed a change in my eating habits when I go to Rita's. It's all you can eat. And I eat all that I can eat. And it's really made me think about like the choices I also make. Because not only am I eating more than I usually would, because I'm like, hey, it's all you can eat, you might as well. But sometimes my actual choices, I'm like, you know what? Maybe I'll just go for 2 cookies. Because when I'd usually only get one, because instead of having to pay for one cookie, like it all's included. So that's why I say it encourages unhealthy eating habits. Do you guys think that's true? When you guys go to all you can eat, like buffet style things, do you tend to eat more than you usually do?
Yeah, definitely. It's just the opportunity is there. There's food in front of you. You pay a base price for it, and you're going to get your money's worth, whether that means eating a lot of the food or eating a little bit of every food that they have there. You're going to get your money's worth, and even if it's a very cheap price, like at Rita's, $5.50, that is near nothing for a meal, especially on a college campus like Madison. So I feel like it does, in fact, encourage unhealthy eating habits. Just thinking about last year, before that was even initiated, just going around the dorms, the dining halls in the dorms and the residence halls, it's very easy to practice unhealthy eating habits and consume food that may not be the best for you, but probably tastes pretty good, because some will argue that the university food isn't really that good. So you might want to get the meal that's not as healthy, but will probably taste better than some of the other alternatives that they have there, that while they may be healthy, they probably don't taste that good, or maybe you're just not feeling that particular item right now after you ate it last week, or after you ate it 3 days ago, 2 days ago, or literally earlier that day. Because I know there are times when you walk into the dining hall and it's very easy to not crave something. That's for sure. And I feel like if you have a buffet style setup where it's all you can eat, you have the opportunity to choose and pick what you want to eat for one price. You don't have to choose this and that. You can literally get whatever you want and not have to really worry about paying different prices for it. So I feel like it does encourage unhealthy eating habits, definitely. And that's unfortunate.
Yeah, I agree. Especially because I feel like when it's all you can eat, you do eat all you can eat, because you're like, why not? But like healthy eating habits, that's not how you're supposed to eat. And you're not even supposed to eat until you're full. You're supposed to eat until you're satisfied, not until you feel like you can't take another bite, which I feel like is what's happening with the all you can eat.
Yeah, I totally agree. I feel like it's something that is actually encouraging these habits. Like I said before, when I went to dining halls, one, I'm trying to be more fiscally responsible. I think about, okay, what should I eat? How much should my average meal cost? And things like that, in order to make sure like I have the appropriate amount of funds throughout the year, and I'm never going like a day where I'm like, you know, food insecure, because food insecurity in college is a real thing. So just trying to make sure like you stay fiscally responsible in managing your money. But when you're like taunted in a sense with these low prices and abundance of food, it makes sense as a college student or even as a person in general to be like, okay, in that case, let me just eat all I can, because that's what it's actually telling me to do. So that was something that I found interesting about that. Also, now going to the next side of the topic, which is the idea that these meal plans in general are just discriminatory towards lower income students. I know I had to write an article on this my first semester freshman year. I'm a sophomore now, about that in general, because I know before the meal plans were set in place, first of all, meal plans were new as of last year. They didn't have meal plans at all in the subsequent years. And when they brought this whole idea up of meal plans, there were actually protests. One protest happened in Gordon Dining Hall, which is like one of the bigger dining halls other than, I would say, Four Lakes here on campus. And at Gordon's, definitely the biggest Southeast. And at Gordon's, like, people literally stood there protesting the idea of meal plans, because like Gordon's to them were, food was really expensive compared to maybe making your own food, going to the grocery store and things of that nature. And they were like, well, you shouldn't force students to buy these plans in order to attend this university or live in university housing. So what do you guys think? Do you think it was, oh, and then I know from both sides, from doing the blog post I had to do on it for my class, was that the actual administration was saying, no, if anything, we're trying to help lower income students, because now they can use their financial aid to directly pay for cost of food, whereas beforehand, they would have to do it on their own. So with that being said, and knowing the thoughts of both sides, do you guys think it's discriminatory, or do you guys think, no, that's just, it's a school, meal plans are actually common in schools?
Yeah, at first, before you said anything, I would have said meal plans are discriminatory, because again, like, I feel like, yeah, it's not as expensive, but I feel like dining food is pretty expensive. And like we were saying before, like there's not many options and you get tired of the food, which is the reason why I didn't get a meal plan, because so many times last year I walked into the dining hall and then walk right out because I didn't want anything. Like I lost my appetite, which, you know, probably a good thing to lose weight. But you know, going to what you said about it's helping them with their financial aid, I feel like, yeah, it could, but just because they put that in place doesn't mean they're going to get more financial aid. So it could be that they're, instead of, they might not get as much financial aid and they're going to have to take out loans to cover that cost, versus like just cooking and like buying food on your own wouldn't be as expensive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm kind of torn between the meal plans, just because as a freshman coming in, there are a lot of, and I'll get into this when I lead the conversation, there's a lot of pros and cons to the meal plan coming in as a freshman straight into university. But I feel that overall the meal plans are, they don't really cater to low income students in a way. I feel like it could have been done a little more effectively to benefit the students overall. I feel like right now it is okay. As you were saying, there were protests about this. People were not very happy about it. There was kind of this sense of, we don't really want this and you're putting it on us, so we kind of have to do it if we want to come here, but we don't really want it. But at the same time, some people were like, okay, this is cool. I live in the residence hall. I have the dining hall set up already, so I don't have to think about where I'm going to get food every day. I just need to think about how much money I have on my meal plan. And I know for some people, sheesh, that was like, I mean, like a month and a half into the semester, you're just like, I don't have any money on my meal plan anymore. So I need to put more money on because I've already committed to this meal plan. So I need to finish this semester, but I just don't know where this money is coming from. I could cook, but then going into the cooking realm, you need a lot of things to begin cooking, which I've learned this year living in an apartment with roommates cooking for myself. Cooking isn't just a, I want to cook this. It's going to the grocery store. You have to have pans, pots. You have to have all the ingredients. You have to have the time. You have to have the energy. You have to have the will to cook for yourself. But overall, I will say, going back to the original statement, I feel like the dining halls are, the dining hall meal plans for freshmen can be a little tricky for freshmen and can get a little in the not too fair type of area. Yeah.
Yeah. Just looking back at the blog I wrote, one of the quotes that people were saying, they were calling Gordon's the priciest grocery store in town. And so I thought that was just a thing, because sometimes when I do walk into Gordon's, and especially Flamingo Run, you notice their prices are higher than they would be in other convenience stores, and yes, which are even higher than they would be in grocery stores. Yeah. So it is true that the prices are higher and that students could allocate their funds if they weren't forced to use them, if they weren't forced to buy a meal plan, and another way to seek cheaper alternatives. But at the same time, I think an important aspect that goes into it is kind of what Darion was saying, which was, okay, but at least if they have a meal plan, they're just worrying about how much money do I have left in my account, not how am I going to even feed myself. You know, because with a meal plan, if you do the math correctly, you can actually say this is how much I can spend per day,
yeah,
in order to make sure I have food for the rest of the semester. Yep. Whereas if you are just trying to do it based off your own account and like how much money you have in your account, I feel like that kind of fluctuates, especially for lower income students, the amount of money you have. So then that can actually put more stress on you, because you're like, hey, I kind of need to eat, but I also need to even wash my clothes, do my laundry, you know? So those things can come, whereas with the meal plan, it's like, no, these funds are like already set aside for this purpose, and I can't do anything else with it. Like, even with the WIS card, the meal plan money is on a different account than your actual WIS card account. So really, you can't do anything with that money but eat. And I think having that money reserved just for eating is something that is important and can and did help many people. So I know, as a student who had to have a meal plan, I actually did like the meal plans for me, because I wasn't that person who, I was never that person who always cooked for themselves. Now, I think this also can go, the meal plans can serve against people like that, because some people use cooking as a way to relieve stress. So they now have to buy this meal plan, but at the same time, they are still going to keep cooking, because that's just their way of making sure they stay like healthy mentally. That's like, cooking for some people is a stress reliever. For me, I was never that person. So the meal plan actually helped me and made me happy, because I was like, hey, before class, let me just grab a quick meal from Gordon's and go to class. Or like, let me just do something from get something from Rita's and leave. Yeah. So I think for me, meal plans were beneficial, but I can see how some people wouldn't think that. But I want to ask you guys, what's people who started their freshman year with the meal plans and like completed their whole school year with the meal plans, did you think it was beneficial for you?
Yes. I thought it was beneficial for me just because, like you were saying earlier, it was something I didn't really have to acknowledge every day or think about. Wake up, oh, where's my money for my food? How much money do I have left? Because it is in this separate account that is exclusively for the dining halls and the little convenience shops around campus, where you could get snacks throughout the day or get your meals at the dining hall. And that was pretty cool because it was there. You knew it was going to be there. You knew where you could use it. You knew how much you had. You knew how much you were getting. And having the meal plan as a student that lived in the residence hall, you do get discounts on the food. That makes it a little cheaper, and you don't have to pay the tax on the food, which makes it a little better. But I did like it. I did like having the meal plan. It was, I could always eat out if I wanted to. I could always use my own money if I wanted to go somewhere else. I could always go to the food trucks. It was never an issue of eating anywhere else. It was always just I knew that I had the meal plan. I knew where I could eat. I knew that there was money on there exclusively for me to eat throughout the day and be secure in that. And one of the points that I'm going to get into later is, depending on what tier you had, that would determine how often you checked how much money you had on your meal plan. But for me, I did enjoy it. It was good for me. Yes.
Yeah, I think for me, I didn't have a problem with it, but like looking at it this year where I didn't get a meal plan, I liked that I didn't get a meal plan much more. Because, well, for me, I feel like it was different. Like, for some people, they did run out of money. For me, I had leftover. I still have money from a meal plan. I occasionally go to Gordon's, not necessarily for food, but maybe for snacks. But again, like, it is very, like, Flamingo Run is very expensive because, like, and I don't understand why, like, they're saying that they want us to, like, go to these dining halls to save money or whatever, but it's like they're taking advantage of us because they know that it's right there. We're going to go there instead of, say, like, go to, like, Walmart or, like, another store because it's right there and we're going to spend the money.
Yeah. And in terms of discriminatory policies, the school actually said first, like, they were like, well, we actually don't think one is discriminatory. We're trying to help lower income students. And even so with that, there actually was, I don't know if you guys knew, there was a policy set in place for students to opt out of the meal plan if they had proof of religious or medical reasons for it. So if they were like, hey, like, the meal plan doesn't work for me because of my religion and, like, I need to prepare food a certain way and that's why it doesn't work. Or even if you're like, hey, I'm gluten intolerant or, like, I'm vegan and this is just something the meal plan really wouldn't work, there is a policy set in place for them to opt out of the meal plan. So that's something that the school wanted to make sure was known. It's not, they felt trying to help students, and that's why they have it set in place, not necessarily to make anyone feel left out. As I'm sure we'll get into later when other people lead conversations, I just also feel like the different tiers sometimes can make people feel insecure, even like, you know, when you swipe the card and says how much you have left and it's running down, you see other people have more than you have. And even if you started off with tier one, which is the lowest tier you can have because that's all you could afford, but now you're running out and you see other people have all these other ones. So I also feel like maybe there should be another way to go about how showing how much money you have left in your card. I get it makes sense to have people check, like, at that moment every time you swipe to know how much you have left, but at the same time, I also know sometimes people felt like, oh, I don't really want to go because it's busy right now and I'm running out of money. But with what Jessica was saying in terms of having all, like, money left over, so we had the same meal plan and we pretty much ate most of our meals together last year. So we, like, both ended, like, first semester with, like, an extra, like hundred plus, like, two hundreds of dollars. And I remember we were just like, how did people run out? But then again, we did have the luxury of starting with the higher tier. We didn't start with tier one, so even just taking that into consideration. But yeah, that's pretty much all I had. Any comments on that?
I feel like the only comment I have is that I feel like they should make it optional, and I feel like they should make it, like, and they say they have, like, there is, like, a, like, way to get out of the meal plan, but it's, like, for certain exceptions, and it's, like, what makes that exception so much, like, better, you know? Mm-hmm. Like, yeah. I feel like if you just, for your own reasons, you don't want it, you should be able to say, no, I don't want it. It should be right. Optional, like it is, like, the rest of the years.
Yeah, like sophomore year, I thought the way they handled it was great, which was like, do you want a meal plan? Yes or no? If so, what tier? And they didn't ask for any reason. You didn't have to go through any special, like, university requests to not have it. It was just clicking. Yes, I want one. No, I don't.
Yeah.
And I also think my sister's school, with meal plans, they actually run out at the end of the year. How ours carry over to the next year, so we still have our money from last year. At her school, actually, she would say people would just be going at the end of the year and just buying random stuff that they don't even want because their meal plan at the end of the day, like, all their meal points expire. So I also like how our university does it where ours doesn't expire, because I also think I would think it was wrong to make someone's money expire, you know? But yeah.
Yep, I'm good.
I feel like, especially since they're making it mandatory, you have to have this meal plan. It would be very wrong to then take away that money that wasn't used for food.
Yeah.
I feel that. You done?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. You want to go a break or you want to do...
I feel like we can just jump into the next one.
Let's do it. All right, cool. Well, I'll present my little information I have over here. And when I was just thinking about this topic and doing some research and looking into some things, I was looking at the meal plans and the prices of them. The lowest one, tier one, is $1,400. The second one is $2,100. And the highest one is $3,100. So from the lowest to the highest, we go from about $1,400 to $3,100, which is a little over double. But the difference between the lowest one and the highest one is so substantial, it's almost ridiculous. The highest one, you get free beverages at all the dining halls. You get $200 of extra cash. You get 10 free coffee drinks. You get discounts on care packages. And the lowest one, I think you get the discounts, which is like, wow. So it's kind of in the meal plans are set up. They tell you to choose based on your eating habits and how many meals you anticipate to have on campus a week. And I feel like for a freshman coming into a university, that's a hard thing to anticipate. How many meals am I going to eat a week at the dining hall? I don't know. I have no idea because I've never been in this situation. This is my first time being in a situation where I'm by myself. Eating is my priority. I don't have my mother to rely on. I don't have my parents. I don't have friends. I don't have family. It's just me at this college campus waking up in my dorm and I'm hungry. Where do I go? Go to the dining hall. Okay, well, I'm going to get hungry at lunch. Where do I go? The dining hall. Oh, I'm hungry for dinner. Where are you going to go? The dining hall. So logically, you would be like, I want all my meals throughout the day for the most part to be at the dining hall. And that option would be tier three. But the thing is, tier three, It's a very high price. It's $3,100. It doesn't sound like a lot. That's a pretty good amount of money. That's $3,000. That's a lot of money. And if you get that tier three, you're getting so many benefits with it that makes it so much better. So if you can afford to get tier three, it's almost you should get tier three. If you can afford it, you should get it. But if you can't afford it and you're in a low income situation where you need a meal plan and you're like, okay, I'm going to get the lowest one. I'm getting 1400. I'm getting the one for 1400 tier one where I don't get most of those benefits. All I get is the discounts. I don't have to pay the tax. I'm eating. But I think that's only half of the amount of meals a week that you would eat as a regular person. And that's just not enough. And it kind of sets you up where you're in this weird situation where you need to plan where you're going to get that extra money. Because if you get tier one and then halfway through the semester, you need to add more money. You're just adding more money. You're still not getting these benefits. You're still not getting any of this other stuff. You're just adding more money because you need to eat. And sometimes you might not even be able to add any money because you don't have the money. So I feel like it's this really weird situation where students are faced with this either or situation where the odds are stacked against them to the point where they would rather and they would almost need to get the higher priced option to sustain themselves on campus. And I'll let you guys respond to that.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. I even know something that I just remembered. It's like I know someone who, like, in terms of is it like kind of like discriminatory and like should you just get the higher one or not? Who you might as well get the higher one because they wanted to apply for financial assistance, like food stamps or like to help with that. And the first question they ask you is if you have a meal plan. And if you have one, then you're all like, for the most part, you're usually not eligible for it. And so even for lower income students having to know, like, I'm forced to have this meal plan, but I really can't afford food. But now that I have a meal plan, the government is saying, oh, I don't need assistance with buying food because I have a meal plan that I couldn't even afford. Right. And in terms of just adding more money to your card at the end, yeah, for the most part, I do know some people who only eat like one meal a day. I don't think that's the healthiest way to go about it, but I do know some people who do that. And kind of a big reason for it is because they just can't afford to eat more than that one time a day. And so that kind of goes to the tier one meal plan and like how people who get that sometimes they do live off of it and don't add more money to it, but they're not living a healthy, sustainable life. They're living a life of like where they're actually hungry and they go about their day hungry, but they know they can't afford to eat. And I think a big thing to think about when you're going to get a lower tier plan is also just think about where you're eating. I also had some friends who would have a tier one, but then they would go to like the more luxury places, yep, like the unions, and that's the only place, yep, they would eat. And I would be like, okay, I want to sympathize with the fact that you can't afford like meals and you're like, wow, I already ran out and it's only semester's halfway through. Like, I really want to sympathize with that. But at the same time, I also think about the fact that we have to be smart with our money and recognize that not everyone is as privileged as everyone else. So if you know you're not as privileged to have a tier three meal plan, you can't eat as if you have a tier 3 meal plan. Like, maybe you should frequent dining halls more frequently rather than going to unions, because unions are more expensive and you don't get the benefits that he was talking about, where it's like the resident, like 20% discount or something like that. You only get like, I think, 5% off at unions, if I'm like not correct. And even with the 5% off, like, the prices are actually higher than they would be at dining hall. So also just recognizing where your actions actually influence something. If you know you don't have the money, then maybe go to dining halls, which does sound wrong, saying you shouldn't be able to go to the same places other people can, but it's just a fact, like, if you can't afford it.
No, definitely. And eating at the unions, especially Memorial Union, that will really hit you if you are not set up for that. That will really hit you hard, because you can go to Gordon's and get a meal for $5-6. You can go to Memorial and get a meal for like $11. Mm-hmm. And it will be a really good meal. But guess what? You just missed out on a whole nother meal that you could have had. And for tier three, you're like, oh, okay, I'm chilling. I'm going to the Union. I'm going to Union South. I'm going to Memorial. I'm going here. I'm getting this drink with my meal. I'm getting some coffee. I'm going to get a milkshake. Nah, for tier one, you're thinking, okay, I think I should go here and get this. Yeah, I should get a sandwich because it comes with chips and or drink. Like, let's be realistic here. And that is kind of unfair, because sometimes, and just think about social peer pressure. If you have a group of friends and they're all going to Memorial Union, you're going to Memorial Union and you're going to eat there, whether or not you want to pay that much or not. You're not gonna say, oh, guys, sorry, is it okay if we go to Gordon's, or can I just meet you guys there? I'm going to get some food here. Some people will do that, but a lot of people won't, because they don't want to be excluded. They don't want to feel that awkward pressure of not being able to provide for themselves. And then as a tier three, I had that tier three. And last year I would buy stuff for people. I would buy meals for tier people, that my friends that had tier one or tier two, if their money was getting low, because I knew I literally had the money. And I literally had the money. And I had more than enough money to provide for myself and eat comfortably. So I'm like, sure, bro, I got you. Don't even worry about it. Oh, don't even worry about it. I got it. Like, it's not that big of a deal, because you have no idea. Not only do I have the most money, I have the most discounts. And I have $200 extra that I didn't even know that I had. So, yeah. No, yeah. I could buy this. I could buy this $5 meal for you. Let's do it. I don't care.
More incentive?
Yes. That is the word I'm looking for. It is more incentive to go to Memorial Union when you know that you have that money to just kind of spend and eat comfortably and not have to worry about it. So I feel like that was interesting. And just going into something else, meal plans in general can create stress for students and even result in them eating a lot less than they want to, because they are scared of running out of money. Mm-hmm. So you either have this thing where you're scared of running out of money, so you don't eat, or you're like, I need to eat, and then you run out of money. So now you're faced with this other either or in the middle of the semester when it's midterm season, and you're eating, and you're like, oh my God, I have $20 on my card, and I have two more months of school. What do you do? What literally do you do? Do you call home to your parents that are probably in a low income situation as yourself? Do you reach out to your friends? Do you reach out to the university? How do you go about managing not having enough money to eat? That is such a stressful position to be in as a freshman 18-year-old on a college campus in Madison, Wisconsin, especially if you did not grow up in Wisconsin, because not only do you have to deal with eating, you have to deal with the culture shock. You have to deal with the people. You have to deal with the weather, the environment. Oh my God, that's a lot. And classes. Let's talk about classes, you know? So I feel like meal plans can put a lot of stress on students. And transitioning to college can be really hard if you don't have a meal plan and you're trying to cook, because now you're trying to transition into college and handle all of these things, all these aspects and components I just mentioned, while also cooking for yourself and providing for yourself. And like I was saying earlier, cooking is not something where you just pick up the spatula and you're just going ham. That's like, we are not SpongeBob out here. You need pans, you need pots. Luckily, my grandmother sent me some pots and pans when I got out here for my roommates and I, and that was dope, because man, I don't know what I would have been doing. I wouldn't have had nothing to cook with. And then, you know, I'm like, okay, I think I'm ready. You know, a couple weeks in the semester, I'm going to start cooking something. I go to the store. I'm like, oh my God, I don't know what to buy. I call my mom. What do I buy? Okay. You have seasoning? No. You have this? No. So I got to buy all this extra stuff. I go home. Oh my God, I don't know how to cook. So I call my mom. Hey, well, how do I cook this meal? I'm sitting on the phone with her for 30 minutes cooking the most basic meal in the world. And then just, you have to keep doing that until eventually you have everything you have, everything you need set up to cook. And now all that you're buying is the actual groceries to cook. And I feel that in the long run, cooking for yourself is the cheaper alternative to meal plans. But for a freshman, I feel like the meal plans are a better, well, it is a better setup for a freshman coming into college, not having to think about cooking. I think that the meal plans can provide a very ease of mind, pretty much, for a student that has a lot more to deal with than eating. And as a sophomore now in an apartment off campus, I still have money on my WIS card, and there's this thing called the red card, and I use the red card to buy groceries, and that's been really cool, because I'll go get some groceries, cost like $12. I got three meals, you know what I mean? So that's dope. And now I'm having all these meals for less than it costs to even get a meal plan, or some of the meals in the dining hall. So overall, I feel like meal plans are kind of shaky, but for freshmen, I feel like it is a good alternative if you can get that tier two or tier three. For tier one, it seems kind of like a setup where you're just setting yourself up for failure. If you are not in a position to get tier one and then add on more money at a later time. If you are getting tier one and expecting that to last you the whole semester, you are literally setting yourself up for failure to not eat. And I am saying that blatantly, and I will say this again, the opinions on this show do not reflect the views of WSUM, the University of Wisconsin-Madison, or the Board of Regents, because I'm sure that they do not feel the same as I. But you know, the amount of meals that you get display that you are not expecting to eat all of your meals on campus. And one of my friends, she got tier one. A month in, she's running out of money already, because she's supposed to be eating one or two meals a day at the dining halls, and she's eating three. And she's like, where's all my money? I'm like, well, you're eating every day, every meal at the dining hall. But what else is she supposed to do? She's a freshman. She just got here. So, yeah, not a fan. Overall, not a fan.
Yeah, going back to what you were saying about the kind of peer pressure and your friends. So my freshman year, I feel like I really was not spending money. I was going to Gordon's and I was getting like $3-4 meals, because I mean, it's just there wasn't too many options, and I didn't want to really eat the food because it wasn't the best. And then I met LaToya. And I did not know. I mean, I knew about Union, South, and Memorial, but I didn't know that you could use your WISCard meal plan for food there. I thought, oh, if I go there, I have to use my own money. So I'm not. I only went to Gordon's and dining halls. And when I met her, she started taking me. She's like, oh, no, you can use your WISCard. And I'm like, what? And that's all I started going to. And my money just...
slowly but surely.
Not even slowly. Like, yeah, when you fastly start going, you see a rapid just drop. I was like, that was $100 in the same time it took me to spend like 50.
Yeah. Going, yeah.
I'm like, what?
Definitely. Going to Memorial, if you were to eat three meals in one day at Memorial, you could potentially lose anywhere between, especially food and a drink. If you get food and a drink, you could lose up to $40 probably.
Mm-hmm. A day.
A day.
A day. It's crazy.
Compared to 15 in the dining halls a day, which is like still like sheesh, but not as bad as 40. So that's all I really had to say about this.
So I had to sit her down and I had to have a conversation. I need to just stay at quarters.
Yeah.
It was actually, but one thing I just do want to recognize that I didn't even realize at first, we're all sitting here kind of in places of privilege in a way, because none of us have experienced a tier one meal plan.
Nope.
So none of us know what it's like to have to try to live off of that much money. But so that is something to acknowledge. But one thing I would say is, like, math is your friend. Like, I'm sorry. Sometimes with me, like, in order to give myself a reality check, I stop. I look at my account balance, and I look at how many weeks are left in the school, and I divide and see how much money I can spend per day on a meal.
Oh, yeah.
And for me, sometimes it's good. Like, I remember last semester, first semester, the end of first semester, towards the end, I was like, oh, I can spend $30 a day on meals. Okay, then I'm good. I can continue my same pattern. But then from going to, like, a lot of unions and stuff, this was spring semester, my freshman year, I was like, wow, I only have, like, $7 left a day. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
So you know what? I'm going to stop going there. And I'm going to start going to dining halls. And that for me is how both semesters, again, coming from a place of privilege, I didn't start with tier one, but still tier two, I didn't run out of money because I did do reality checks. So just guys remembering that math, like, sometimes I feel like people don't take that consideration. Like, mm-mm. They see their account. They're like, oh, I have $100. I still have a lot of money left. But it's like, okay, but how much time are you trying to spread this $100 by? So just remembering to do those calculations to make sure you actually are, like, knowledgeable about how much money you can spend. And you know, like, okay, I can't treat myself because I have this much money.
Yeah.
But maybe if I treat myself today, tomorrow it's straight dining halls. Whereas, like, today, since I did go to the union, or I did want that extra shake or something. So just reminding yourself and, like, you know, like I said, remembering, do the math and be realistic about how much money you have.
Yeah, just thinking about that, I definitely did the math very, 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 very often. It was, like, kind of ridiculous. Like, I was kind of obsessed with, like, looking to see how much I could spend a day just so I could have it in the back of my mind. And I will say it is a lot easier for that number to go down than it is for it to go back up. Once you have reached a certain point, it doesn't really matter what you do. That number is not going to go up that much, especially if you're farther into the semester and you're like, wow, I only have like $9 a day. You still have to eat. Like, you're not going to stop eating. You're not going to, like, even if you go to these other places, you're still going to be spending that money. And now you're just stretching yourself out like, whoa, okay, now I need to just calm down. Oh, maybe I shouldn't have got that. And I will say I got really, 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 not really, but man, I gained some weight last year because I'm at Memorial eating pizza, an entire pizza, like, every week. Like, I would go every Friday. Like, oh my God, that is so delusional. Like, this semester, I have yet to have a pizza from Memorial Union. I'm saving that. I'm saving that for a celebration of some sort, because that will really get you caught up so fast. It's kind of crazy.
No, yeah, the gaining weight. So Jessica and I would have a burger 4 times a week for Memorial. And yeah, so not only do you see your price in your account going down rapidly, but you see yourself going up on scale rapidly. You're like, whoa. But and all, what's it called, like, jokes aside, just remember how much money you have and make sure you are taking into consideration when you're buying your food.
Yeah, and there are resources on campus that can help you if you are running out of money and you need food. There are resources. I'm not too sure what they are. I know friends have told me about them and let me know about the things that they did to get around not having a lot of money on their card or running out of money on their food accounts. So just reach out if you're in that position. Reach out to somebody in your residence hall or somebody in the dining halls, and just figure out if there's a way you can either get some more money, if there's a way you can start working for something for some more money, if you can just figure it out, because we all have to eat. And if you're not eating, that is no bueno. I would tell out that is not good. Okay. Everybody needs to eat. It is a very, very, this is a very prestigious institution. The classes are not easy. So please eat. That is one thing you should do. Eat and drink water. Please drink water. Your brain does not function if it is dehydrated. Your brain is mainly made of water. So are you. Please drink water. Please eat. And that's all I got to say about that.
I do know, I mean, I'm sure there's more, but I know, I don't specifically know them, but I know I've heard of them. One of them is UW has like a food pantry type of thing. I'm not sure where or how, but you know, if you look, I'm sure you'll find it. But yeah, food pantry, you just get free food. And then there's also, I'm not sure exactly what it was, but it's basically the leftover food from Gordon's. They basically package it up and like deliver it to you. So I'm not too sure on the logistics of it, but
yeah, I know that there's, I think there might be something in the sack. There's a refrigerator down on the third floor that has food that you can take, and it's usually like fruits and vegetables, and we all know we need our fruits and vegetables. So if you need some fruits and vegetables, I think that's open for students that need it. It is a need-based system, so please don't come and just start taking food if you can literally walk down the street and pay for the food yourself, because there are students there. It's probably a lot more than we think, but there are plenty of students that are struggling with eating and struggling with keeping up with their diet and managing their health on campus. So please be mindful of that. Reach out to your friends. If you notice them not eating, maybe take them to the side, maybe hit them up another day and ask them if they're doing okay. Ask them if they do have enough money on their cards, if you could help, or if you can both collectively try to figure something out so that they're eating and they're getting the nutrition they need to get through the semester. So yeah, just be mindful of that and always just take other people into consideration, and I feel like we'll all be a little better off. Anybody else have anything to say?
No, I feel like we covered a lot of it. All you can eat is awful. It wants you to just eat everything. Encourages it.
Yeah, all you can eat is a setup. There are a lot of setups on this campus, and a lot of them are not very good setups. They set you up for failure. But that being said, we're going to wrap up today's show. It has been a pleasure. This is DJ Classic. You know what it is. You know what's cracking. This is WSUM 91.7 FM Madison. I'm here with my co-host.
Hi, LaToya Michelle.
Right, and we have our guest.
Jessica.
Yep, so that's the end of our show today. We talked about some meal plans, talked about some inequities on campus, and I'm sure you all had some very strong opinions on that if you were listening and you go to UW or you're connected with the UW system in any way, or even if you're on a college campus, because a lot of these college campuses are making these meal plans a requirement for freshmen in some sort of way. So I'm pretty sure this is something everybody can relate to, and I hope you enjoyed the show. We will be back next week. I'm not going to tell you what the topic is because it's a really good one. I know you're going to want to listen to it, but I might post something on my Instagram about it. So you can also follow me on Instagram at _CLASXIC_, and you can follow LaToya at
LaToya So, LaToyaSO.
That's us on Instagram. So feel free to follow us, DM us. That's cool. We want to hear your feedback on how you all like the show. Of course, we like the show because, you know, it's our show. But it really helps to get feedback from you all and see how you guys are enjoying the content that we put out. So with that being said, we'll be here next week, and I hope you'll be here too. And we're out of here. Thank you.
Bye.
This isn't where